This is chapter 11 of Dr. Rajiv Mal's book. The chapter is Software Reliability and Quality Management. We will see the question and answer. The first is identify the factors which make the measurement of software reliability a much harder problem than the measurement of hardware reliability. The answer would be the hardware failures. Most of the hardware failures, they are caused by wear and tear. But the software failures, they are not caused by wear and tear. But on the flip side, they are due to the design and coding errors. So the reliability of hardware is stable after repair, whereas the reliability of software will change after each error fix or debug. Second is, discuss how the reliability changes over the lifetime of a software product and a hardware product. See, for a hardware product, the reliability appears like a shape of a bathtub. Okay, it is like this. So this is the bathtub curve over its lifetime, but the software reliability over a large period of time, continuously it improves rather than degrading, it improves. So if you see this diagram, you can see that this is the hardware product, right? And in this hardware product, this is the failure rate and this is the time. Now this is how the bathtub is seen. Here we have a useful life of that hardware product, and here the wearing out starts, and it may reach to some peak after which the product may not be usable. In case of software product, the failure rate and time same in x and y axis. So the useful life after testing would be like this, and after that it will become obsolete. So I must not say that reliability increases actually, but reliability factor is not that what you find in hardware. You know, you can make software more reliable if you design it well, if you code it well, and that reliability will be persisting. That will not wear out. Next question. Explain using one simple sentence each what you understand by the following reliability measure. PFOD. A PFOD of 0.001. What is this? PFOD of 0.001 means that this is 1 out of every 1000 service requests is expected to result in a failure. Okay. ROCoff of 0.02. ROCoff of 0.02, it means that 2 failures are expected over 1000 units of time. This PFOD is nothing but the probability of failure on demand. That is probability of failure on demand. So this one out of every 1000 service request is expected to result in failure. While the ROCoff means frequency of occurrence of failures. Okay, frequency of occurrence of failure. That is the 0.02 indicate 2 failures are expected over 1000 units of time. Okay. MTBF of 200 units, that is mean time between failure. So 200 unit indicate that once a failure occurs, the next failure is expected after 200 unit of time. So in this case, the time measurement are real time and not the execution time as in the MTTF. Availability of 0.998. So availability of 0.998 indicates that over a unit time interval, the chances of system operating without a failure is 99.8. If this is the time you have taken, the software is going to run without failure for 99.8% of the lifetime. Then the question is, define 3 metrics to measure software reliability. Do you consider these metrics entirely satisfactory to provide measure of the reliability of the system? Justify your answer. I leave it to you, but I'll tell you what are the metrics. Metrics are MTTF, MTBF, MMTTR, that is mean time to failure, mean time to repair, mean time between failures. These are the various software reliability metrics. How can you determine the number of latent defects in a software product during the testing phase? Latent defects. For that, we use error seeding technique. The number of latent defects can be determined using the error seeding technique. So what we do, we seed some error or plant some error into the software. Say 100 errors we have planted. And we try to find out that how many errors we can detect or the testing can detect. Say 90 has been detected. So the difference of what has not been detected and the amount of numbers which have of errors which has been planted, we can easily find out the number of latent defects with a simple formula. Next is true and false. A is the reliability of a software product increases almost linearly each time a defect gets detected and fixed. The answer is false. You know, you'll be tempted to answer it yes, but each time the error is fixed, reliability may not grow by constant amount due to certain reason. First, you can have an error fixation that is imperfect. An error may give rise to additional errors. This is the imperfect error fix. And then diminishing returns. What is this? Diminishing returns. This means that as errors are detected and fixed, the increase in reliability, they are reduced, or reliability, increase in reliability reduces. Next, as testing continues, the rate of growth of reliability slows down, representing a diminishing return of reliability growth with testing effort. We have just answered this question, or true or false, in this subpart of previous question. The answer is true, because the error which frequently result in failure are fixed first. Therefore, the initial errors to be fixed result in higher reliability growth than the errors which are detected and fixed later. Next is the modern quality assurance paradigms are centered around carrying out thorough product testing. Quality assurance paradigm, the answer is false. You know, thorough product testing is not even possible. You cannot thoroughly test a product until unless it is life threatening. So modern quality assurance paradigms are centered around the concept that if a good process is rigorously followed, then the product is bound to be good. So they talk about quality assurance, talk about that the processes which you are adopting or you are following should be followed religiously, or you can say rigorously. Next, an important use of receiving ISO 9001 certification by a software organization is that it can improve its sales effort by advertising its product as conforming to ISO 9001 certification. Actually, in present scenario, this is true. If you place in an advertisement that your company is ISO 9001 certified company, then people will be, you know, first of all impressed, and they will be bound or inclined towards your product. But in our theory, the answer would be false. Why? Because the ISO certification is awarded with explicit understanding that it can be used only corporate advertisement and not product advertisement. You will never see a product containing that it is ISO certified. ISO is not that certifying agency. ISO is just certifying that the processes which were used to make that product are ISO certified, and they have been followed as per ISO guidelines. So they are not advertised with the product, as the certificate is not given by any specific product but the processes. Next is, what does the quality parameter fitness of purpose mean in the context of software products, and why is this not a satisfactory criterion for determining the quality of software products? Fitness of purpose. What is this quality parameter? The modern view of quality associated with a software product, there are various quality factors which are associated, like portability, usability, reusability, correctness, and maintainability, etc. To give an example why fitness of purpose is not a satisfactory criterion for determining the quality of software products, just consider a software product that is functionally correct. That is, it performs all functions as specified in SRS document, but has an almost unusable user interface. What you are going to do if you can't even use it properly, and you are saying that it correctly implement all the functionality, what is the use? So this is the idea why this fitness of purpose quality parameter, they are not satisfactory criteria to determine the quality of software products. Next is, why is it important for a software development organization to obtain ISO 9001 certification? Now this is de facto. If you have no ISO 9001 or any kind of software process standard, then your company is not considered to be following the process emancipation or development effort. So the benefits that accrue the organization about ISO certification is, first, the confidence of the customer in an organization. It increases when the organization qualifies for certain certification like ISO 9001. This is especially true in the international market. In fact, many organizations awarding international software development contracts, they insist that the development organization has to have certain kind of certification like ISO 9001. So now it has become vital for software organization involved in software export per se or software import to obtain the ISO 9000 certification. ISO 9000 requires a well-documented software production process to be in place. So well-documented software production process contribute to the repeatable and higher quality of developed software. Also, ISO 9000 makes the development process focused, efficient, and cost-effective. Then ISO 9000 certification points out the weak points of an organization and recommend the remedial action, because in ISO 9000 there are audits, there are internal audits, there are external audits. So the auditor would see, would observe, and if at all some remedy has to be provided, he is going to, or the committee is going to recommend or suggest. Then the ISO 9000 sets the basic framework for the development of an optimal process and total quality management, TQM. Next is, discuss the relative merits of ISO 9000 certification and the SCI-CMM based quality assessment. SCI-CMM is the Software Engineering Institute Capability Maturity Model. ISO, as you know, that it is International Organization of Standards. So these merits you have to, for quality assessment, you have to point out. So the answer is, ISO 9000 is awarded by International Standard Body. So therefore, the ISO 9000 certification can be quoted by an organization in official documents or communication parties and tender quotations also. But SCI-CMM assessment is purely for internal use. You cannot say that I am SCI-CMM certified, because SCI-CMM was developed specifically for software industry and therefore addresses many issues which are specific to software industry alone. So this SCI-CMM goes beyond quality assurance and prepares an organization to ultimately achieve the total quality management. You know, in fact, this ISO 9001 aims at level 3 of SCI-CMM only. But we have 5 levels in SCI-CMM, you know, right from the initial to the repeatable, etc., to the manage, etc. So SCI-CMM model provides a list of key process areas, KPAs, on which an organization at any maturity level needs to concentrate to take it from one maturity level to the next. So it provides a way of achieving gradual quality improvement. 10. List 5 salient requirements that a software development organization must comply with before it can be awarded ISO 9001 certificates. And what are some of the shortcomings of this ISO certification process? Our answer would be, first is, all documents concerned with the development of software product should be properly managed, authorized, and controlled. So this requires a configuration management system has to be in a place. So SCM is very important as far as ISO 9001 certification is concerned. Next is, the proper plans should be prepared, and then the progress against these plans should be monitored. Whatever document you make, you have to abide by or conform to that document. Then important documents should be independently checked and reviewed for effectiveness and correctness. And the product should be tested against the specification, that is SRS we are talking about in terms of our software. Then several organization or organizational aspects should be addressed. For example, management reporting to the quality team, etc. With the help of suitable example, discuss the type of software organization to which ISO 9001, 9002, 9003 standards respectively are applicable. Now this is a confusion in our mind always, that what is the difference between this 9001, 2 and 3, and which organization are provided 1 and 2 and 3 awarded actually. So 9001 ISO does not stand for International Standard Organization, but it is for International Organization of Standardization. So ISO 9001, this standard applies to the organization engaged in design, development, production and servicing of goods. So this is a standard that is applicable to most software development organizations. That is why you will see most of the organizations, software organizations, they say that we are ISO 9001 certified. In case of ISO 9002, this standard applies to those organizations which do not design products but are only involved in the production. If you are producing the product, then you are liable for ISO 9002. So example of this category of industries, which includes steel and car manufacturing industry, you buy the product and plant designs from the external resources, and they are only involved in manufacturing these products. Therefore, this ISO 9002 is not applicable to software development organization. What about ISO 9003? This standard applies to organizations involved only in installation and testing of the product. Only in installation and testing. That is why ISO 9001 is so popular with software industry. So let me summarize it again. ISO 9001 for those institutions or organization which design, develop, produce and service. ISO 9002 is for those who are only manufacturing, not designing. ISO 9003 are for those who are just involved in installation testing, not other things. Next is during software testing process. Why is the reliability growth initially high but slows down later on? Why? See, the errors which frequently result in failure, they are fixed first. Or you can say that if we prioritize the cause of failure, the most important or the most number one or in the priority level or priority list, the number one failure causing error has to be fixed first. Therefore, the initial errors of the fix result in higher reliability growth. Then afterwards, you have various errors which are not producing so much effect to the software, and there are certain errors which will never be invoked. So they are fixed later. That is why initially reliability growth is high, but it slows down. 13. In an organization, if an organization does not document its quality system, what problems would it face? If you are not documenting quality system, what problem are you going to face? The answer is, without a properly documented quality system, the application of quality controls and procedures, they become ad hoc or on the fly basis, resulting in large variation in the quality of products which are delivered. One more reason is that an undocumented quality system sends a clear message to the staff about the attitude of the organization towards quality assurance. The attitude is not very comprehensive. So you need to lay it down, document the quality control and quality assurance system, and then have to confirm and apply or make sure that it is implemented. That is what quality assurance does. What according to you is a software quality software product? Can you answer this? What according to you is a quality software product? Well, the answer is quite simple, that the product which conforms to the requirements and is appreciable by the user with minimum errors is a quality software product. Now discuss the stages through which the quality system paradigm and quality assurance method have evolved over the years. We will see just now in the diagram stages of evolution. Before that, we'll answer this 9001, 9002, 9003. We have already answered this because we have seen this 9001 is for those organizations which are designing, developing, testing, and servicing. And the ISO 9002 is for manufacturing industry. 9003 is for only implemented installation and testing firms. So this is ISO 9000 is applicable to us. This is what I was talking about. Let us see this first. Then we'll go to this question 17, next one. Okay, it is here only. So the stages of evolution of quality system. We have to talk about the stages through which the quality system paradigm and the quality assurance method have evolved over the years. This is how it has done or gone. Quality assurance method, quality paradigm. So first we were talking about the product assurance. Now we have come down to the process assurance, not product. If processes are adopted or they are done properly, of course you will have a good product. Then in quality assurance method, first it was inspection, quality control, quality assurance, and then the quality, total quality management. So inspection followed by quality control, by quality assurance, and total quality management. So the question here 17 is, in a software development organization, identify the persons responsible for carrying out the quality assurance activities. Explain the principal task they perform to meet this responsibility. Quality assurance is the responsibility of both the development team and the quality assurance team. So you have a quality assurance team, which is, or you may assign some people who are doing, they are involved in software development only, or different expertise, you can just make a team or make a committee that, okay, you are going to do the software quality assurance part also. So this quality assurance team is responsible for first auditing the projects, reviewing the quality system, development of standards, procedures and guidelines, and production of reports for the top management, summarizing the effectiveness of the quality system in the organization. So the development team is now responsible for the reviews and testing, etc. Next question is, suppose an organization mentions in its job advertisement that it has been assigned a level 3 of SCI CMM. What can you infer about the currently or current quality practices at the organization? And what does this organization have to do to reach SCI CMM level 4? Let me tell you, there are various levels or maturity levels of SEI CMM. SEI is a software engineering institute. The model is actually capability maturity model. So in this, we start with this. IRDMO. Initial, repeatable, and then we come to this. This is very important, you know, D1. Because we are talking about the level 3, and this is the level 3 which we need to see. So this is defined. Initialize, or you can say that it is initial level. This is repeatable, this is defined, this is managed, and this is optimized. So in this question will answer like this. The organization has defined processes, so it has a well-defined and meaningful training program. So it carries out various reviews during the development process. And in order to reach 4, it has to go to manage them. That is to concentrate on the process and the product metrics now. Process and product metrics. Let me tell you that at the defined level, an organization has developed its own standard software process through greater attention to the documentation, standardization and integration. While at managed level, an organization monitors and controls its own process through data collection and analysis. So this is product and process metrics. Next is, suppose as the president of a company, you have the choice to either go for ISO 9000 based quality model and SCI CMM based model. Which one would you prefer? Give the reasoning behind your answer. See, this is a very tricky question because there are various factors. The choice would depend on various factors. First is, SCI CMM provides a step-by-step path for quality improvement. So there are a number of steps in which you reach to the quality improvement. So if in your organization, it does not follow any quality policy, then you go for SEI CMM, which is preferable. But if the company needs to bid for government contracts or work with, say, European clients, then the ISO 9000 certification would be desirable. SCI CMM is internal to your company because you are making software, and this ISO 9000 gives you a global perspective, a global recognition. Next is, what do you understand by total quality management TQM? What are the advantages of TQM? Does ISO 9000 standards aim for TQM? The answer is, total quality management or TQM, it advocates that the process followed by an organization must be continuously improved through the process measurements. TQM says that the process followed by this organization has to be improved through process measurements. The TQM goes a step further than quality assurance, and it aims at continuous process improvement. This is what we are trying to emphasize. So TQM is saying that beyond documenting processes, try to optimize them through the redesign. So the answer will be like this, but the second part, does ISO 9000 standard aim for TQM? No, ISO 9000 does not aim for TQM. You know, first you have inspection, then you have quality control, then quality assurance, then finally TQM comes. Next is, what are the principal activities of modern quality systems? Principal activity. The quality system activity will take all the following. First, you have to audit the project, review the quality system, develop the standards, produce procedures and guidelines, and the production of reports for the top management, summarizing the effectiveness of the quality system in the organization, right? So you have to audit the project, review the quality system, develop your own standard, and then you have to make the reports and to show it to the top management. Next, in a software development organization, whose responsibility is it to ensure that the products are of high quality? Explain the principal task they perform to meet this responsibility. Say, whose responsibility? See, we have answered this already. This is the responsibility of the organization as a whole. You know, no individual or no one group of people can do it. Besides this review and testing, which is normally done by the development team only, the other activities include the auditing, reviewing, development of standards and procedures, and production of report for the top management summarizing the effectiveness of the quality system in the organization. Next is, what do you understand by the repeatable software development? Organizations assess at which level SCI CMM maturity achieve repeatable software development. So before answering this question, let me tell you that what is repeatable level of CMM, five maturity levels of software processes. At the repeatable level, basic project management techniques are established and successes could be repeated because the requisite process or processes would have been made, established, defined and documented. While at the initial level, the processes are disorganized, they are even chaotic. The success is likely to depend on the individual efforts and is not considered to be repeatable because processes would not be sufficiently defined and documented to allow them to be replicated. So in this, we are going to answer that the repeatable software development means that an organization can repeat its success in one project, a similar project, because it has been documented now and you have started following certain procedure. And that procedure is our process is only, you know, constrained to the project, not the whole organization. So organization assessed at SCI CMM level 3, it achieved repeatable software development, right? So SCI CMM 3. Next is, what do you understand by KPA, key process areas, in the context of SCI CMM? And would there be any problem if an organization tries to implement higher level of SCI CMM KPIs before achieving lower level KPIs? Justify the answer using suitable examples. KPA, that is key process areas, that indicate, KPAs are that indicate the areas an organization should focus to improve the software process to the next level. So these are the key process areas. That is why these processes are key. And you need that they are indicating that the areas, these are the areas an organization should focus to improve the software processes. So SCI CMM provides a list of key areas on which the focus, of which to focus to take an organization from one level of maturity to the next. So it provides a way of gradual quality improvement over several stages, and each stage has been carefully designed so that one stage enhances the capability already built up. For instance, it considers that trying to implement a defined process, that is level 3, before a repeatable process level 2 would be counterproductive, as it becomes difficult to follow the defined process due to the schedule and budget pressures. Next is, what is Six Sigma Quality Initiative? To which category of industries it is applied, and explain the Six Sigma technique adopted by software organization with respect to the goal and procedure and the outcome. First, let me tell you about Six Sigma. Six Sigma is a quality program that, when all is said and done, improves your customer's experience, lower your cost, and build better results. Six Sigma at any organization simply mean a measure of quality that strives for near perfection. Six Sigma is discipline, data-driven approach, and methodology for eliminating the defects in any process, from manufacturing to transactional and from product to service. So the statistical representation of Six Sigma describes quantitatively how a process is performing. That is, to achieve Six Sigma, a process must not produce more than 3.4 defects per million opportunities, right? And the fundamental objective of Six Sigma methodology is to implement the implementation of a measurement-based strategy that focuses on process improvement and variation reduction through the application of Six Sigma improvement projects. Okay, in this you have DMAIC, DMADV, etc. Okay, so let us answer this question now. The purpose of Six Sigma is to improve processes, to do things better, faster, and at lower cost. So it can be used to improve every facet of business, from production to human resource to order entry to technical support. So Six Sigma can be used for any activity that is concerned with cost, timeliness, and quality of result. The fundamental objective of Six Sigma methodology is to implementation of measure-based technology strategy that focuses on process improvement and variation reduction through the application of Six Sigma improvement projects. So this is accomplished through the use of two Six Sigma sub-methodologies, DMAIC and DMADV. The Six Sigma DMAIC process, that is, define, measure, analyze, improve and control, is an improvement system for existing process falling below specification, looking for an incremental improvement. While this Six Sigma DMADV process, that is, define, measure, analyze, and then design, verify. So this is an improvement scheme used to develop new processes or products at Six Sigma quality levels. And it can also be employed if a current process requires more than just incremental improvements. Both Six Sigma processes are executed by Six Sigma Green Belts and Six Sigma Black Belts and are overseen by Six Sigma Master Black Belts. Green and Black by Master Black Belts. Next is, what is the difference between process metrics and product metrics? Give certain examples. So, product metrics measure the characteristics of the product being developed, such as its size, reliability, time complexity, and understandability. While the process metric reflects the effectiveness of the process being used, such as average defect correction time, productivity, average number of defects found per hour of inspection, average number of failures detected during testing per LOC, etc. Next is, suppose you want to buy a certain product and you have to keep a purchase precondition that the vendor must install the software, train your own manpower on that, and maintain the software for at least a year. Only then would you release the payment. Also, you do not foresee any maintenance requirement for the product once it has worked satisfactorily. Now you receive bids from three vendors. Two of the vendor quote 3 lakhs and rupees 4 lakhs, where the third vendor quotes 10 lakhs, saying that the prices would be high because they would be following a good implementation process, as they have been assessed at the level 5 of SCI-CMM. Discuss how you are going to decide and whom to award the contract. The answer is pretty simple. Since both the vendors undertake to maintain the product for a year, and the business rules are not expected to change in future, the lower bid can be accepted. So these were certain questions on quality. These questions are very important because in interview and in exams, the Six Sigma, CMM and ISO, these are always asked. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.